1 Peter chapter 5, open them, turn them on, whatever kind of device you might have. 1 Peter chapter 5 is where we're going to begin. And as you can see on the big screen, the title of the message I want to bring to you this morning is Take Out the Slack. Take out the slack. Now, you know, the last couple of times, with one exception, when we had baptism, I talked about faith-filled, not fear-filled, and so we tried to deal with this area of fear. And then last week, if you were with us, we talked about this idea of overcoming negativity, and the idea of negativity being something that can hinder you in every area of life, amen? And so we talked about fear, we talked about negativity. Today, I want to talk to you about overcoming a slackness in our lives. In our time today, I believe, and again, this is not necessarily a series, these are individual messages, but I feel like the Lord has put it on my heart. Again, sometimes it's not good to start a new series in the summertime. Maybe if we started in the beginning of the summer, it'd be fine. But I want to talk to you about slackness today. I'll define all that in a little while here. I believe, again, it's something the Lord has put on my heart to share with all of us to help us, because how many of you know that in the summer, we can get a little bit slack? Three of you agree with that. But anyway, 1 Peter chapter 5 is our beginning text, if you don't mind. And I've been talking and not turning there, but that's all right. I can fight it fast. 1 Peter chapter 5. And let's just read verse 8. Familiar passage for most of us, I'm sure. Notice what Peter said by the Spirit of God. And then we're going to pray after we read this opening text. Peter said, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank and praise you for your goodness and your mercy toward us. And Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit, who is called our teacher, will open up the eyes of our understanding to the Word of God. Enlighten us to your Word today, we pray, Father God. We pray, Father God, that each heart would be like good ground, ready to receive the seed of your Word today. And that I believe it's a word in season, something that you are wanting to say to all of us, including me, by your Spirit and by your Word today. And so help us have receptive hearts and help us be blessed and encouraged, edified in all of these things. Father, we thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. And so as we read here again, notice it says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Now, all of you know that even though it's a great time of year to take a vacation, it's a great time of year to take some time away or whatever. How many of you know that we got an adversary, the devil, who does not go on vacation? Are you awake today? Help the preacher. Would you help me here just a little bit? We are an interactive kind of church. You know, you can interact with me to a certain extent, as long as you don't, cause problems. But anyway, you know, when I ask a question, you can answer it. You can even say no. It doesn't matter. Notice how the Amplified says it this way. It says, be well-balanced, temperate, sober of mind, be vigilant and cautious at all times. For that enemy of yours, the devil, roams around like a lion roaring in fierce hunger, seeking someone to seize upon and devour. And so as I mentioned to you, the message is entitled, Take Out the Slack. Take out the slack. Why? Because we have an enemy that is going about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he might devour, seize a hold of and devour. And we want to be sure that we are attentive, that we are watchful. In fact, if you'll notice here some definitions I want to share with you from that verse of scripture. First of all, the word sober. It means calm and collected in spirit. It means to be discreet. It can refer to being sober in terms of alcohol, but it's talking about more in a figurative way here, that we're to be sober or clear-minded. He's encouraging us, Peter, by the Spirit of God, to be clear-minded, to see clearly, to not, you know, be out there spacey and all that kind of thing, right? And then the word vigilant from this particular verse also means a mindfulness of threatening dangers, which with conscious earnestness and an alert mind, everybody say alert mind. In fact, just as a confession of faith today, say this with me, my mind is alert today. In Jesus' name, amen, thank you, amen. Be alert, amen. He says again, he says, or the meaning is a mindfulness of threatening dangers, which with conscious earnestness and alert mind keeps it from all drowsiness and all slackening in the energy of faith and conduct. And so you'll notice that this idea of vigilance means that you're not slacking off, that you're not a slacker. I want to say to you today, if you don't remember that, don't be a slacker. Look at your neighbor, say, don't be a slacker. Oh, I know you hate it when a preacher says that. But anyway, you know, don't you, I hate it if I'm in the audience, somebody says, say this to your neighbor. I hate that. but I do it to you sometimes anyway, don't I? All right. So anyway, it says again that we're to be watchful, that we're not to slack off, that we're to be acknowledging the fact that there are dangerous things, that we have an enemy that is really diligent himself in order to do whatever he can to devour us. Now, I don't say that to you for you to get fearful. I don't say that to you for you and me to be looking around every bush and blaming everything on the devil, all right? But I am saying it to you in a balanced way, hopefully, this idea that we don't want to lack being alert to the fact that we have an adversary that would like to destroy us, that would like to hurt us, that would like to tempt us, that would like to whatever, in order so that we might not continue to run our race the way God would have us run it. Are you with me here today? Yes. All right, we are. There's a war going on. I think most of you would agree to that. There is a war going on. And I'm not talking about in Iraq or anywhere else. I'm talking about a spiritual battle that is taking place. And you and I need to, even though, again, not in a fearful way, not in any way like that, and not seeing the enemy around every bush, but we need to be alert to the fact that there is an adversary. And that is a lot of what I just want to say to you today. Let's not slack off. Let's be alert, right? Yes, yes. Is everybody all right here today? All right, so as we go on with this, notice now Joshua 18:3, the children of Israel are a perfect example of this. Notice what Joshua said to Israel. He said this, and Joshua said unto the children of Israel, how long are you slack to go to possess the land which the Lord God of your fathers has given you? Well, most of us know the story that Joshua was assigned the task of leading the children of Israel into the promised land. Now, you and I, we have a promised land. It is not a literal land. It is not anything to do with that, but our promised land are the promises of God, our inheritance in Christ. We are called heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus, aren't we? And so, you know, to that degree and in that way, we have a promised land to inherit. We have an inheritance in Christ. We have an inheritance that says that we are more than conquerors. We have an inheritance that says that we are victorious in Christ, that we are the healed of the Lord. We have an inheritance that says, as we read for the offering, that our God, as we are givers, will provide all of our needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. We have an inheritance of the love of God shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whereby we can love God and love other people. We have an inheritance of joy that comes by way of the presence of the Spirit of God. I mean, we have an inheritance, don't we? Yes. And yet, on the other hand, like Joshua said to the children of Israel, we can be slack in entering into our promised land, if you will, if we don't do certain things and be vigilant and observant and all these things and be aware that there's an adversary, just like they had adversaries. We have an adversary, only our adversary is not flesh and blood, but our adversary, what does Ephesians 6:12 say, is not flesh and blood, but principalities and powers and rulers of the darkness of this world and spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. Amen? But let me just say this in order to try to bring a balance to this. You know, the enemy, his greatest weapon against you and me is deception. That's his greatest weapon against us, right? And so really, we could say this, that we are our biggest problem if we allow deception from the enemy to conquer us. Isn't that right? And so the answer to deception is truth. The truth is found in his word. And so the more we know the truth, the more we will be free. The more we know the truth, the more weaponry we will have to combat against him. As Jesus, when he was tempted, spoke the truth of God's word, and it was a sword of the Spirit. Isn't that right? And so I say that to you, not to be fearful of the devil again, and also to realize that yours and my biggest problem really isn't the devil. Yours and my biggest problem is us. Ourselves, right? Because if we allow him to deceive us, if we allow ourselves to give in to him, we have authority over the adversary in the name of Jesus and by the power of God's word. Amen? And so again, I don't want you to be afraid of this idea that we have an adversary and that he's like a roaring lion. Somebody said, you know, he's like a roaring lion. He might have a lot of growl, but he doesn't have any teeth. Jesus kicked him out. Amen? All right, but we can give him teeth if we allow his deception to have its way in our lives. All right, now, let's go on from here and see some other things pertaining to this. Notice the definition of the word slack. A lot of meanings of this word slack. Remembering that part of the word vigilance means to not have slackness in our lives. And remember the name or the title of the message is Take Out the Slack. Or I could have almost entitled it, Don't Be a Slacker. Maybe I should have tied, that's better anyway. But anyway, definitions of the word slack, it means to relax. It means to become discouraged. It means to become weak, to let drop, to leave alone. Someone also said to be negligent, even though I don't have it in this list, to be negligent, to let go, to abandon, to be lazy. Now, let's think about this. In yours and my spiritual life, right now, today, July 31st, 2016, think about this just for you and for me to consider this about myself. Is there something in my spiritual life that I have relaxed in? Are you following me here? Something in my spiritual life that I have abandoned, or something in my spiritual life that I become lazy about? Are there things that I become apathetic about, or the things that I am not diligent about any longer? Let's think about this and consider this and do a little examination of ourselves today. Because again, we want to take out the slack. Isn't that right? Because again, you know, summertime especially, I think that we can get so, and we need again to relax physically and things, but we don't want to relax spiritually. Is everybody all right? Yeah. All right, so let's go on with this now. Notice this from Merriam-Webster's dictionary, some other meanings of this word slack. It means not holding fast. In other words, you're kind of letting loose of some things that one time you held fast to, hopefully. Not earnest or eager or slow. All this is meanings of the word slack. Characterized by slowness, sluggishness, or lack of energy. Now, we ask ourselves in pertaining to spiritual things, are we lacking energy? In terms of our prayer life, are we getting sluggish in terms of our study of the Word of God? Are we getting sluggish in our worship? Are we getting sluggish in our fellowship? All of these things are things that we need to consider about our spiritual life. Why? Because we have an adversary, the devil, who roams around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may seize hold of and devour, right? Notice as it goes on with this meaning, this definition from Webster, it says lacking in usual or normal firmness and steadiness. And then notice the last one, not using due diligence. Everybody say diligence. And so we could say this, if you'll allow me to, and I'm not going to take a long time for you today, but we could think about it like this. We could think about slackness. The opposite of slackness then is diligence. And so when we're talking about take out the slack, I'm really talking about being diligent in the things of God. Everybody say diligence. Diligence. Now, I understand that, you know, diligence is not what you wanted to hear about today. But nevertheless, it's so important, so vital, and it strengthens us. And it's not intended to be a burdensome thing. Diligence in the things of God is to be an edifying thing. Diligence, you know, in the things of God is to be something that builds us up, something that encourages us. You know, have you noticed, I don't know if you've noticed this, maybe you remember this happening in your life at one time and you've gotten away from it and you forgot, but I can't tell you what a difference it makes to read your Bible every day. So simple. But man, what an amazing thing. What an amazing power there is in the Scriptures that brings such edification, such strength into our lives when we read it every day. Not even necessarily read a lot of it every day. Not even necessarily trying to find some kind of reading program to follow every day. Do you know you're better off memorizing one good verse than you are trying to read through five chapters? But what a difference that makes. I cannot tell you, you know, it's like the old Scotsman said, it's better felt than telt. You can't explain it. You can't verbalize it. You can't articulate it well enough. You've got to experience it in order to really get the revelation of how much reading your Bible every day brings you strength and ability to overcome that adversary of yours and mine. Amen. And it becomes a joy. It becomes a joy, not a burden. Yes. Do you know reading your Bible is to be a joy and not a burden? Do you know prayer is supposed to be a joy and not a burden? Yes. Is everybody with me today? Yes. And so you know what? If you find that it's a burden, you pray and you say, God, I want to pray. But to me, it feels like a burden. Help me find joy in my prayer. Help me find joy in my reading of the Word. Open up the eyes of my understanding to your Word. Let me glean truth from your Word, Father God. Stir in me some freshness. Stir in me the gift of God, or I stir up the gift of God so that I might receive that which you have. Ask God for a spiritual renewal. You know, that's a great prayer to pray. Amen. Because we all need, if you were standing up here looking at you, I can guarantee you would agree with me that we all need a spiritual renewal. Amen. Everybody with me here? Okay? And so, you know, you say, but what do I do? First thing is pray. Ask God. God, renew me spiritually. Give me a spiritual awakening, Father God. You know, if you pour out your heart to Him, I believe He'll pour out His Spirit on you. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Amen. It's just amazing if we'll just pour out our hearts instead of just enjoying. Sometimes people love being miserable. Now, I'm not saying you're miserable. I'm not saying you're miserable, but you might be. But sometimes people enjoy being miserable. Did you ever notice that?
Yeah.
You've heard the expression, misery loves company too, isn't that right? And some people, you know, they wouldn't even know how to be. They like the attention that being miserable brings. You know, people pay attention to them and say, why are you so sad? Why are you so miserable? But you know what? They need to shake themselves out of being miserable and say, no, the joy of the Lord is in me, and that's my strength, amen?
Amen.
Now, that wasn't part of my notes, so maybe that was for somebody, amen? All right, so as we look at some other things, everybody say diligence.
Diligence.
Diligence will take out the slackness in our lives, amen? But yet diligence biblically is not to be a burden. It's to be a joy. It's to be a joy. It's to be a pleasure. As we go on with this, notice now the next thing. Diligence is a key to spiritual and natural success. It is a key to it. And when you think about it in the natural, if you don't have diligence, and you know, we'll define a little bit what diligence means, but I think most of you probably have a pretty good idea. When you think about diligence, it takes diligence to succeed in anything. It takes diligence to succeed in school. It takes diligence to succeed in running a race, a literal race. It takes diligence to succeed at work. Isn't that right? And so why would we think it wouldn't take diligence to succeed in our spiritual life as well? Sometimes I think that Christians have the idea, well, you know, I don't have to apply myself. I remember, and I've said this before, and I don't propose to say anything to you this morning that's going to be revolutionary. But you know what? It doesn't have to be revolutionary. What it needs to be is Holy Spirit inspired and right on time as to what the Holy Spirit wants to say to our hearts today. Amen? You know, the Bible says that, you know, you need to be careful about always going about with itching ears wanting to hear something new. That didn't go over too well. I got quiet, all right? But doesn't it say that? It, you know, how you know, the Athenians, the Greeks, you know, they went around, they always wanted to hear some new thing. They had itching ears, essentially, and always wanted to hear some new thing to scratch that itch of hearing something new all the time. No, we don't need something new necessarily. What we need is something fresh by the Spirit of God. And if it's by the Spirit of God, it's going to be like it's new. It's going to taste good every single time. Amen?
Amen.
And so again, I want to encourage you today. I don't know about you. I want revival. I want revival in my heart. I want revival in your hearts. I believe God has great plans for abounding grace as God has called people together in this place. And He's got great plans for every church in the capital region and beyond that are following Him. You know, God has not called one church to a city. God calls many churches to a city. Isn't that right? And every one of them has a uniqueness and a perfect plan for them to carry out in order to bring about all the plan that God has for the capital region. Isn't that right? And God has a part of that plan for you and me that are called together in this place. And so what does that involve? That involves people helping. That involves people coming together. That involves people putting their shoulder to the plow, so to speak, isn't that right? And to do it out of joy and peace and love for the kingdom of God. Because you know what? I can only do my part. I can't do your part. Amen. I can't do the other things that need to be done. Some people say, well, Pastor, you know, the lawn needs mowing. Well, you know, that's good, but if you want a good message on Sunday morning, I may not be able to take time with the lawn. You understand what I'm saying to you? And so what happens is pastors sometimes, for example, this is just an example. I'm throwing this out the top of my head. I wouldn't even plan on going this direction. But you know, sometimes people think, well, you know, the pastor can do this or so-and-so can do that. Pastor's wife or, in our case, Ben or somebody else, he can do all that or whatever. But when they do those things or when we do certain things, then other things go aside, don't they? And then next thing you know, is, oh man, pastor's just feeling, he just sounds so dry on Sunday mornings. Oh, Pat, I don't get anything out of what pastor's preaching anymore. I wonder what's wrong with pastor. Something's wrong with pastor. He's not spiritual anymore. Well, maybe I spent too much time doing things I wasn't called to do or anointed to do, and I wasn't able to spend time with God so I could hear from Him and give to you what the Lord is saying to us. Amen? I'm serious about that. And you know, believe me, part of the problem is me. Because I love I really love mowing the lawn. And I'm not just talking about lawn. I really love, you know, I know my wife tells me, you know, you need to let Jake mow the lawn more. I say, yes, I know. And I have, I do. He did yesterday. But I enjoy mowing the lawn. And so I have to fight that. And I enjoy getting out of that office because I'm an outdoors kind of guy. You understand what I'm saying to you? I know, I'm not saying I need to spend more time in the Word because I'd rather do that, although part of me, my spiritual man, does want to do that and wants to get a good word for you. I want you to come on Sundays or Thursday nights whenever we're sharing. I want you to get some gourmet cuisine spiritually that's going to build you up and help you grow and equip you in the things of God. No question about it. Amen. But that doesn't mean I don't enjoy doing some of those other things as well. Amen. Are you hearing what I'm trying to say to you? I'm just kind of sharing from my heart a little bit here. But in any case, say diligence. Diligence. Takes out the slackness. Amen. And so notice here, some of the definitions of the word diligence. Are you getting anything from this morning? Some of the meaning of the words diligence. First of all, from the Old Testament, it figuratively meant this: determination, eagerness, and to be industrious is part of the meaning of this word diligence. Then other definitions include what? To use speed, to make effort, to be constant in effort or exertion to accomplish what is undertaken. And so it means basically, just sum that up, this idea of diligence means that you are eager and determined to accomplish what God wants you to do in our context. Amen? Amen. And so there are several areas. I'm just going to give you six areas in the Bible that talk about and encourage us to be diligent. Will that be all right? Yes. All right. And so some of these areas of our lives that need to be diligent. Notice the first one that is mentioned here is that we need to be diligent in seeking God. We need to be diligent in seeking God. Now, what is seeking God? Seeking God includes many different things. Seeking God, we know that we have Him. We know that He lives within our hearts. But seeking God would imply the idea of intimacy with Him, spending time with Him. There is a time when every Christian needs to spend some time, quality time alone with God, with their Bibles, and just praying in the Spirit, praying with your understanding also. Times when you need to be worshiping even by yourself. Don't you think so? Amen. I mean, the singing, I mean, the worshiping God. You say, well, I don't sing. That doesn't matter to God. It's always a joyful noise. Amen. 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 You may say it's noise. That's all right. It's a joyful noise. And that's all God cares about. And it's from the heart. Amen. 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 And so notice what Hebrews 11:6 says. One of my favorite passages, maybe it's one of yours as well. That should be in the next frame. Hebrews 11:6. Is it coming? Yes, it is. All right. Notice, but without faith, it is impossible to please Him, for he who comes to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him. Amen? Amen. Notice the word diligently, determined, eager, right? And so we're diligently seeking Him. He is a rewarder of those that diligently seek Him, the Scripture says. And so there are great rewards. When we talk about this word diligence, in context of spiritual matters, in context of our spiritual life, diligence in those things are rewarding in our lives. Amen? Yeah. It's rewarding in our lives. And so we're to be diligent in our seeking of God. Going on with the next one, the next thing that we're to be diligent in, and again, I'm only giving you six. This is not by any means necessarily all of it, but in obeying God and His Word. Diligent, that means determined. That means that we are eager to obey the Word of God. And the Scripture is Deuteronomy 6:17. You'll notice it says, you shall diligently keep the commandments, or the word of the Lord your God, His testimonies and His statutes, which He has commanded you. Turn with me, if you don't mind, real quickly, to James 1. Would you go there? James 1. Are you receiving anything out of this morning? James 1. Very familiar passage for many, I'm sure, but you know, we never want to get so familiar that we miss things. Amen? And so James 1, beginning with verse 21. James is right after the book of Hebrews, not too far from the back of the book. All right, James 1, beginning with verse 21. Are you there? It says, therefore, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. Then he goes on, he says, but be doers of the word. How many of you know that a doer of the word is equivalent to being an obeyer of the word? Isn't that right? And so he says, for if anyone, first going back to verse 22, but be a doer of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. So if you are a hearer of God's word only, That means you can still be deceived. I'm going to just say that again. Because many times, you know, we may say, well, the truth is the remedy for deception, but there's more to just hearing the truth that's the remedy for deception. It's hearing the truth and doing the truth, or being a doer or an obedient person to the truth, that helps you from being deceived. Isn't that right? And so he says this, he says again, he says, but be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets. Everybody say forgets. Forgets what manner or what kind of man he was. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty, which is what? The word of God, looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues. Everybody say continues. Now, I would suggest to you that continues suggests some diligence as well, doesn't it? Yeah, yeah. Because you're continuing in it. You're keeping on, being a doer of the word of God. And so he says, and continues in that law, perfect law of liberty, or the word of God, and continues in it, and it shall not be a forgetful. Notice forget versus not forgetful. Not be a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work. This one will be blessed in what he does. Well, that goes along with this idea of being rewarded for being one who seeks God. He is saying in this, if you're a doer of the word, if you're a doer and a hearer, you're not going to forget. And if you don't forget, you're going to be blessed. Everybody hear that today? Amen. And so many times, if we're just a hearer of the word, we'll forget. But if we're a hearer and a doer of the word, it gets implanted into our heart, into our soul, into our mind, into our emotions. It becomes more a part of us. And the more the word becomes a part of us by hearing and doing the word of God, the more, or the less, I should say, that we are deceived, and the more we are blessed. Amen. Everybody say blessed. And so, do you want to be blessed by God's word? If you want to be blessed by God's word, then be a hearer and a doer, or one who obeys the word of God. Amen? There's blessing in obedience. There's blessing in obeying God's word. Amen. And so there's what? There's not blessing by only hearing. There's not blessing by only hearing someone preach. There's not blessing just by that. There has to be a hearing and something done with it. Right? And be diligent about it. Continue in it. This man will be blessed. Amen? Amen. Let's go on just a little bit here, because it's awful quiet in this church. Hallelujah. All right. Let's go on with this. Number three. Now talking about areas to be diligent in. In whatever we do for employment, we need to be diligent. Now, I know this goes beyond, the things pertaining to spiritual things in one sense, but in another way, do you know even your employment is supposed to be a spiritual act? Right. Isn't that right? I mean, really, when you think about it, your employment is your mission field. Your employment is a part of who you are and what you do, right? And so it's not like there's a separation for the Christian, or there shouldn't be a separation for the Christian between the spiritual and the secular. For us, if we're believers in Christ, then the secular is part of our spiritual life, and it's to be that which in which we let our light shine into that world. Isn't that right? And one way we let our light shine into that world is by way of diligence in the things of God. Notice what it says in Proverbs 13:4. You should see it up on the big screen, I believe. It goes this way: the soul of a lazy man desires and has nothing, but the soul of the diligent shall be made rich. But you know, God hates laziness. And you know, I'm not saying to you that you're going to be rich in the sense of being a millionaire, but it does mean that you're going to be rich in the sense of needs met and being able to be so blessed that you could be a blessing and all those kinds of things. That is part of God's plan, as we would see from other scriptures as well. But the idea is here that a lazy man is going to desire. A lazy man is always going to be in want. Yep. Now, I know that none of you need to be hearing this, but how many of you know that our culture today is promoting laziness in many respects? Yeah. Our culture today is promoting the idea of be supported by the government, which is being supported by the taxpayers, which is you and me, and really promoting a lazy type of attitude. Now, I know some people need help. I know some people need supplemental help. Isn't that right? Some people need food stamps. Some people need other things and whatever. But how many of you know that there's a lot of abuse out there, and there's a lot of able-bodied people taking advantage of a system because they're lazy? Are you hearing what I'm saying to you today? And that needs to change, and it only changed by people getting saved, and that is the only answer, really. Christ is the only answer. You know, no governmental system's going to be the answer anyway, right? Amen. And so don't put your faith in politicians, although I think you should vote. You should vote to the closest you can to biblical principles. Right? And I think you should vote because you're called to be a good citizen. And thank God for our nation that has been built on Judeo-Christian principles in order so that we could be here this morning, in order so that we could be really in the history of our nation. The greatest missions work has gone forth from this nation than any other nation on the planet of the earth because of Christianity. Are you hearing? And so you need to vote. Don't not vote. You need to vote biblically as close as you possibly can. Right? And that's enough, I guess I better say right now. But November's coming. Expect I'll be saying a little more. You understand?
Amen.
Of course, you know now, you know, certain groups say, well, you know, pastors, churches, they shouldn't speak or try to sway legislation. Well, you know, I'm not going to endorse any candidates on purpose. But I am going to say that there are guidelines we can follow scripturally and in prayer to help us make a wise choice. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And there's no perfect candidate, is there? No perfect candidate. And so let's go back to the message before I get off track. All right, going on with this number four, another thing the Bible says we are to be diligent in. Number four is that we are to be diligent in our desire to mature and accomplish His will for our lives. Diligent. What diligent? Being determined, being eager to, putting in effort in this area. Notice Philippians 3, 12 through 14. Let's read it and look at this today, if you don't mind. Notice what it says. It says, not that I have already attained or am already perfected, Paul says, by the Spirit of God. But notice what he said. But I press on. Everybody say, press on.
Press on.
You and I are called to press on also.
Amen.
I press on that I may lay hold. Notice all these what I call action type of words. That I press on that I may lay hold on that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. I love that phrase.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus has laid hold of me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Jesus has laid hold of you. And because He's laid hold of us, we're to press on and lay hold of what He's called us to lay hold of. Amen?
Amen.
And would you concur with me that that means some diligence?
Yes.
That means some determination.
Yes.
And so again, He says that I might press on, that I may lay hold of that which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward. We got pressed down. We got lay hold. We got reaching forward to those things which are ahead. I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of Jesus Christ, of Christ Jesus. I mean, again, this takes diligence, this takes determination, this takes eagerness, this takes effort. But there's great reward. There's great blessing in going after this will of God for our lives. Amen?
Amen.
The Lord has laid hold of you if you've accepted Him as His, as your Lord and Savior. You've been laid hold of by Christ.
Amen.
But you've not been laid hold of for no cause or no reason. You've been laid hold of so that you might lay hold of what He has in your life for you. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Say, He
has
laid hold of me.
Amen.
That gives you purpose.
Yes.
That gives you a sense of meaning, doesn't it?
Amen.
And so as we go on with some of this again, notice now number five, the fifth one, we've had several of them, seeking God, obeying God's word, or whatever we do in employment, be diligent in our desire to mature and accomplish His will. And then fifthly, in adding godly character to our faith. Would you go with me to that passage, 2 Peter chapter 5, 2 Peter chapter 5, or chapter 1, excuse me, 2 Peter chapter 1. Are you getting something from this today? 2 Peter chapter 1, of course, all this will be on the website so that you'll be able to access these notes and what have you and look these up later as well. But 2 Peter chapter 1, And beginning with verse 5, I remember many years ago, I preached an entire series on this sequence of things that the Apostle Peter put into this. But notice now, in 1 Peter chapter 1, and beginning with verse 5, Peter, again, by the Spirit of God, he says this. He says, who are kept by the power of God. Am I in the right place? Yes. Who are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it be tested by fire, may be found in praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. I'm in the wrong place. I knew that. I was just testing you. I was in 1 Peter. That was good too, though, wasn't it? I knew something was wrong. Oh, Lord. We need to end this service. 2 Peter, chapter 1, beginning of verse 5. You know, it does get a little hard. I don't want to bring out reading glasses, so I got to stand under the light. I am young, though. I just want you to know that, all right? It's 2 Peter. We got it now. 2 Peter, verse 5. Now you're there, right? You were there all the time. You were always there. But also for this very reason. Does that sound like the right spot this time? But also for this very reason, giving all diligence. Everybody say diligence. Diligence. Add to your faith. How many of you know we all began this walk with Christ by faith in Him? Isn't that right? So it's add to your faith virtue. Virtue meaning the idea of character, to accept the character of Christ. Virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For if these things are yours and abound, you will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's the promise, right? But what's he said? He said we need to add these things. We need to add these things to our lives. Giving all diligence. Add virtue to that faith of yours. Add knowledge. Add all these various things into our lives. Be diligent about that. Be determined. Be eager. Put effort in. Put effort in. People don't like the word effort many times. But how many of you know, in order to be successful in this life, we've got to put some effort into our spiritual life as well. Amen?
Right.
All right, we're going to wrap this up shortly, another hour or so. All right, now, notice, let's go to number six. We've got several different things here. Number six is this one, keeping guard over our hearts. I want us to go to that passage as well. And then, you know, we've just got a few more things, and then we'll end this. All right, but Proverbs, if you don't mind. Proverbs chapter 4. And I know that you know this, many of you know this, but this is so important. It says in verse 20, beginning with, are you there? My son, give attention to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Do not let them depart from your eyes. What's he talking about? The words, his sayings. For us, it's God's word, God's sayings. Notice, don't let them depart from your eyes. Keep them or keep guard over them in the midst of your heart. Why? For they are life to those who find them, and health to all their flesh. Notice, keep your heart, verse 23, keep your heart, keep guard, protect your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. There's nothing more important for a Christian than to guard their heart diligently. In our day, it's more difficult than ever to do. Because in our world today, there is information everywhere, isn't there? I mean, whether it be the internet, whether it be television, whether it be your phones, wherever it is, there's information flying all around us all the time, isn't there? But yet, God's word says that we need to guard, protect, keep guard over our hearts, over our souls, over our minds, diligently. Because out of that heart are the issues of life. So as the heart goes, so goes the life. We could put it this way. As what you have in your mind, what you have in your thought processes, whatever's in there is going to affect your life. You will become out here what you are becoming in your thought life. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
And so what are you filling your thoughts with? What are you being diligent about? Are you being diligent with God's word? Are you being diligent with his sayings? Are you guarding your heart? How do you guard your heart? By watching what you see and by watching what you hear, you guard your heart. We can't emphasize that enough, can we? We need to be so cautious. And again, you don't want to be fearful. You don't want to get paranoid. You want to say, oh, I saw that. I didn't mean to. And then think, oh, my mind's messed up. Doesn't work that way, does it? Or you know, you go somewhere, you know, and you hear something. You know, you're in a grocery store and you hear something or whatever. You know, somebody cussing or whatever. You know, you can't help that. That's not going to mess you up unless you let it. Isn't that right? But you understand, I'm talking about, what are you diligent at? Are you going after the wrong things? Are you feeding yourself the wrong stuff? Isn't that right? Because as the heart goes, as the emotions go, as the soul goes, so goes the life. Right. It'll affect the way that you live. Amen? Amen? Amen. So everybody say with me, guard your heart. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it springs the issues of life. All right, now. Enemies of diligence, real quickly, if you don't mind, go to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. And even though we've mentioned some of these things just by way of the conversation we've had, but look at Hebrews chapter 12. And we're going to end with this. We're not going to go any further because we've said enough. But let me just end with this Hebrews chapter 12, some points I want to make. Is that all right? Yeah. And then you can go home, even though it's raining, maybe. I don't know. I don't even know we needed the rain, didn't we? Yes. Amen. Now, let me tell you something. I'm going to have a bumper crop of tomatoes this year. I'm telling you that right now. Hallelujah. Anyway, Hebrews chapter 12, beginning with verse 1. Are you there? Again, the writer of Hebrews, whoever that might have been, the Spirit of God is the one who matters. It says, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Everybody say, run with endurance. How many of you know running with endurance denotes diligence, doesn't it? It denotes the idea of being eager, of the idea of being determined. If you are running with endurance, it means you've got a no-give-up kind of attitude. You are not stopping for anything. You are going to run your race. Amen. Right? Yes. But yet, notice what can happen. One of the enemies of diligence, notice up on the screen, the first one is unconquered sin. What does he say there? He says this. He says, lay aside every weight and the sin that does so easily ensnare us, so that what? So that you can run with endurance the race that is set before you. And you know, if the writer of Hebrews said to do it, then the writer of Hebrews knew by the Spirit of God that you have the ability to do it. There is no sin, if you're a believer in Christ, there is no sin you cannot have victory over. Isn't that right? In fact, really, legally, you already have victory over that sin. Legally, and it has to start legally. It has to start legally before it affects you practically in your everyday life. Illegally, you're already an overcomer of sin. Legally, sin has no power over you. But the problem is sometimes you need to remind sin it doesn't have any power over you. Isn't that right? Amen. You need to take authority over it. I mean, even the devil tried to tempt Jesus in sinning. Jesus always resisted. He never sinned, but he was tempted. But he overcame how? By the speaking of God's word, applying the word of God, the sword of the Spirit. Isn't that right? Amen. And so you have power over whatever sin could be ensnaring you. Don't think and don't believe the deception that I cannot overcome this sin. That's a lie. Amen? Amen. Say it's a lie. It's a lie when you have had, let's say for years maybe, you've had a sin that's ensnared your life, has bound you up. It is a lie to believe that you cannot be free from it or that you don't have power over it. The Bible said, the Word of God says, you have been delivered from the powers of darkness and you've been translated into the kingdom of God's dear Son. That's what the Word says, amen? So we need to believe the Word, apply the Word, and not believe the lie that says I can't be free, because whom the Son has set free is free indeed, amen? And so you appropriate that by faith. And so don't let that hinder you. Don't let that keep you from running your race. You've got a race to run. Amen. I've got a race to run. Every believer has a race to run and to finish. I've got a friend, a pastor friend, here in the area who is fighting cancer very severely.
And the other day, I felt like the Lord wanted me to say to him, I went to see him twice this week, wanted me to say to him, you know what? Your race is not over.
Amen.
You haven't finished your course.
Amen. Amen.
You're not done. How many of you know we need to believe God? We're not leaving this earth till our race is done.
Amen.
Till we finish the race that's set before us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. And so in any case, that can hinder us, can be an enemy of diligence in our life. Also, unclear goals. It says in Hebrews 12 and verse 1, also, let us run with endurance the race that's set before us. There's things set before us. That's those goals that God has given. God has a goal, goals for your life. By prayer, by seeking Him, you'll get clarity on those, but keep on running. You know, the closer you get to the goal, the clearer the goal becomes.
Amen.
Isn't that right?
Yeah.
If it's out there in the distance somewhere, and just because you can't see it clearly right away, just keep running, because the closer you get to it, the clearer it's going to be. The next one that we want to give you real quickly is various distractions. Notice what it says in Hebrews 12 and verse 2. It reads this way. It says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. How many of you know it says looking unto Jesus? Setting your gaze is the idea of looking unto Jesus. Set your gaze on him. Don't be distracted by all the things the world has to offer, right? I thought of Peter one day, as you know. One day Peter saw Jesus walking on the water. He's on the ship with the other disciples, and Peter says to Jesus, if it's you, Lord, bid me come. And so, you know, Peter had boldness. He might not have been real smart all the time, but he had boldness, didn't he?
Amen.
I mean, so, you know, so the Lord said, come, and Peter just jumped right out of that boat and started walking on the water. But you know what? The difference was this. As long as he kept his eyes on Jesus, he walked on the water. When he began to get his eyes on the waves and the sea and the storm, he began to sink.
Yeah. Yeah.
Let's keep our eyes on him.
Yeah.
Let's not be distracted by what the world has to offer. And if we do, we'll be diligent and we'll complete the race that God has before us. And then finally, in verse 3 of Hebrews chapter 12, it reads this way. It says, for consider him who endured such hostility. Notice, referring to Jesus, it mentions endurance. And really, diligence is a part of that. Who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. And so weariness and discouragement can cause us to lack in diligence, can cause us to be slack in our life with God, in our spiritual living. We can get slack because we're tired. We can get slack because we're weary or discouraged or whatever it might be. And I sense there are many believers, perhaps in this room today, and you've been discouraged. You've been discouraged because you're tired. You've been discouraged because you're running out of steam or whatever it might be. And so you've let off. You've gotten slack in your life, in your spiritual life, in your service to the Lord, and all these things. But I want you to know that God wants to encourage you today that you haven't finished your race, that it's no time to sit in the sidelines, it's no time to sit on the bleachers. It's time to get up and it's time to run and to fulfill the race that God has set before yet each and every one of us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We want to reach the end. And we want to be able to stand before him, every single one of us, to stand before him and have him say to us, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter in to the joy of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
And so I want to encourage you today to shake off weariness, shake off tiredness, shake off distractions, shake off everything that could keep you from fulfilling and running the race that God's called you to. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. And if the worship team would come.